We'll be celebrating the Queen's Platinum Jubilee, a celebration which marks Elizabeth's 70-year reign as the monarch. She is now 96, and if you do the maths, that means that she was 26. She was 26 when she was officially crowned Queen, but she was only 25 when she took on the role and responsibility of monarchy following the death of her father. Can you imagine becoming king or queen at the age of 25? What a huge responsibility for someone of that age. But what we discovered from our scripture reading tonight is that there have been instances throughout history where people younger than that became a monarch. The opening words of 2 Chronicles 34 tell us that Josiah was 8 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem for 31 years. Now, the fact that he's reigning in Jerusalem tells us that he was king over the southern kingdom of Judah. Just to put that in its historical context, big picture, and that is following the reign of Solomon in the 10th century BC, the nation of Israel split into two separate kingdoms. You had the kingdom of Israel to the north with Samaria as its capital, and you had the kingdom of Judah to the south with Jerusalem as its capital. Now, the kingdom of Israel, following the split, it very quickly degenerated into idolatry and into apostasy. And in spite of repeated warnings from prophets like the prophet Hosea, it remained unrepentant and consequently suffered the judgment of God at the hands of the Assyrians in 722 BC. The history of Judah to the south, the history of Judah was a little brighter in that throughout her history, there were some periods of religious reformation. And those were usually led by a faithful king. And here in 2 Chronicles 34, we read about one of those kings. The king's name is Josiah. And we're going to learn four things that we see in the reign of Josiah. The first is in verses 1 to 13, and there we see a concern for the worship of God. A concern for the worship of God. Now, the previous chapter indicates that the kingdom of Judah has come through a very turbulent period in her history. The opening verses of that chapter introduce us to a king called Manasseh and tell us that he did evil in the eyes of the Lord. By the time we get to verse 12, we read of him humbling himself before God and getting rid of foreign gods from the temple. By the end of his reign, verse 17, the people are worshipping the Lord, albeit at pagan sites. But sadly, his son, Manasseh's son, followed his father's former footsteps and not his latter ones. Verse 22 tells us that Amon did evil in the eyes of the Lord as his father Manasseh had done. He worshipped and offered sacrifices to all the idols Manasseh had made, but unlike his father, Amon did not humble himself before the Lord. Amnon increased his guilt. And so by the time little Josiah takes to the throne, spiritual and moral conditions within the southern kingdom of Judah are, what you might say, at an all-time low. But thankfully, not for long. Josiah, we are told in verse 2, did what was right in the eyes of the Lord and walked in the ways of his father David, not turning aside to the right or to the left. And that description of his reign immediately makes him stand out as one of Judah's better kings. For example, of all the kings that they had in Judah, only seven others are described as doing what is right in the eyes of the Lord. Only two others are favorably compared with David, who was the great benchmark, and only Hezekiah is commended for steadfastness like that of Josiah's, in that both he and Hezekiah did not turn aside to the right or to the left. Josiah was undoubtedly one of Judah's better kings. And the secret of his success, so to speak, was verse 3. In the 8th year of his reign, while he was still young, and if you do the maths, he's about 16 years old. In the 8th year of his reign, he began to seek the God of his father, David. Seeking the Lord is a phrase that occurs from time to time throughout the book of Chronicles, and it describes an attitude of humility towards God. It describes a commitment towards God, a devotion towards God, and a desire to live for God. And it is that desire that causes him, verse 3, to purge Judah and Jerusalem of its high places, Asherah poles, carved idols, and cast images. Although the northern kingdom by this time had fallen into Assyrian hands, verses 6 and 7 record Josiah's attempts to eradicate it as well of its pagan idolatry. That's how concerned he is for the worship of God. He goes north into the northern kingdom and he eradicates it of its pagan idolatry before returning to Jerusalem, where he then turns his attention in verses 8 to 13 to the restoration of the temple. That place in Jerusalem which God had chosen for the worship of himself. He seeks to restore the temple. It has fallen into disrepair. It has been neglected. It has fallen into disrepair, and so he seeks to restore it by allocating the funds, verse 9, and the personnel, verse 10, that were required to get the restoration done. And so what we see throughout this first half of Josiah's reign is a concern, a real concern, a zealous concern for the worship of God. A concern that has two aspects to it. A concern that has a negative aspect to it, in that he does all that he can to eradicate false worship. And a concern that has a positive aspect to it, in that he does all that he can to restore true worship. And what we must not forget is that this historical record, and this is where Chronicles differs from Kings, this historical record has been written for the benefit of that later generation which had returned from Babylon, from the exile, to Jerusalem. And it's written to remind them of that generation who returned. It's written to remind them that they too need to have a similar concern for the worship of God. They need to have a similar concern, because if they don't, what they will find, as Haggai's prophecy makes clear, what they will find is that all sorts of things could so easily take priority in their lives. And as a result, the worship of God could so easily be relegated to the bottom of their concerns and to the periphery of their lives. Don't you sometimes find that? As a result of all the things that clamour for our attention in life, and there's plenty of them, we can so easily forget that we have been created. And more importantly still, if we are Christians, we have been redeemed in order to be a worshipping people. A people who worship the true and the living and the eternal God. That is our raison d'etre, as the academics would call it. That is our reason for existence as the people of God, both individually and corporately. And it's one that covers every area and aspect of our lives, as Paul makes clear at the start of Romans chapter 12. Do you remember what he says there? He says, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies, i.e. your entire lives, as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. And then he says this, this is your spiritual act of worship. And as Paul goes on to point out in the following verses, our concern for worship ought still to have a negative and a positive aspect to it. Negatively, says Paul, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world. Positively, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That is the concern for worship that ought to characterize our lives individually. And corporately? Well, the fact that Josiah not only turned his attention to worship sites here, there, and everywhere throughout the country, but also concentrated on the temple, that ought to remind us that that temple finds its New Testament fulfillment corporately in the church of Jesus Christ. And that is why Paul can say to the church in Corinth, 1 Corinthians 3 verse 17, God's temple is sacred and you corporately are that temple. And just as that temple in Old Testament times existed for the worship of God, so we must never forget that our primary reason for existing as a church, our primary reason for existing as a church, is the worship of our God. And so rather than always asking, what am I getting out of church life? Do you ever find yourself asking that question? What am I getting out of church life? We ought also, and primarily, to be asking, what is he, i.e. what is our God, getting out of our church life? Yes, when we meet together, corporately and specifically for what we call public worship, but also in everything else that we seek to do and say as a church. Is our life and our witness, our worship and our fellowship, our actions and our attitudes as a church bringing him the glory which he and he alone deserves? That is a concern for the worship of God. Secondly, verses 14 to 21. And there we see a response to the word of God. A response to the word of God. From what we're told in verses 9 to 13, it sounds as if the temple in Jerusalem was now a hive of activity as builders and carpenters and Levites got to work on the great restoration and renovation project. But then, by the time we get to verse 14, we discover that the renovations have revealed something. While they were bringing out the money that had been taken into the temple of the Lord, Hilkiah the priest found the book of the law that had been given through Moses. Every so often we hear of construction work in this country grinding to a halt, as a workman or as an excavator unearths some ancient treasures, perhaps a few Roman coins or the remains of a tiled floor dating back several centuries. And on making such a discovery, the work stops, the machine goes quiet, and the archaeologists are called in. Well, if that is what happens on a building site, when a few coins or a few tiles are discovered, can you imagine what happened on this building site when the book of the law of the Lord was discovered? Now, this book they've discovered, it may have been the entire Pentateuch, i.e. the first five books of the Bible, or perhaps more likely, it may have been the fifth book of the Pentateuch, i.e. the book of Deuteronomy. And I make that suggestion simply because the issues that are mentioned in the remainder of Josiah's reign are prominent themes within the book of Deuteronomy. But whichever one of those it was known and recognized to be the word of the Lord. What they discovered there in the temple was the very word of God. Shaphan the secretary brings it to the king, verse 16, and says, verse 18, Hilkiah the priest has given me a book, and Shaphan read from it in the presence of the king. When the king heard the words of the Lord, he tore his robes. He gave them these orders, verse 21, go and inquire of the Lord for me and for the remnant in Israel and Judah about what is written in this book that has been found. Great is the Lord's anger that is poured out in us, because our fathers have not kept the word of the Lord. They have not acted in accordance with all that is written in this book. That is Josiah's response to the word of God. Does it surprise you that he responded in that way? It may do, because having heard about all that Josiah has already done in his reign so far, we might have expected them to say something like this. Yes, I know we inherited a terrible mess from our forefathers, but look how much we've done to improve the situation. Look at the Asherah poles that we've torn down and burnt down throughout the country. Look at the work that we've started on the temple. Look at the massive reforms that I've undertaken since coming to power. We may not be perfect yet, but we're a lot better than we were, that's for sure. And as he heard the word of the Lord, I am sure he would have heard a lot of passages that would have affirmed him in what he was already doing. But please note, there is no indication in Josiah's response to suggest that he thought he had somehow already arrived and therefore there was nothing more to do. As Josiah read the Bible, as we would call it, as Josiah read the Bible, he wasn't just being affirmed in what he was already doing, he was also being challenged, seriously challenged, by what was still to be done. That is why he tore his robes, verse 19, and that is why he sends a delegation off to inquire of the Lord, verse 21. One advantage in reading through all the Bible, and one advantage in teaching all of the Bible, is that we get a balanced diet. Because as Paul reminds us in 2 Timothy 3 verse 16, the word of God serves a variety of purposes. All scripture is God breathed, says Paul, and is useful. It's useful for teaching. It's useful for rebuking, it's useful for correcting, and it's useful for training in righteousness. Please note, there are encouraging and challenging uses of God's word, and we need to hear both. We need both individually as Christian people, and we need both corporately as a church. It is sometimes assumed today that the Bible will always produce a feel-good factor in us, affirming us and encouraging us in what we already are and in what we are already doing. And yes, there are plenty of passages that do that. But there are others that don't. And if we never get round to reading and teaching the latter, then we will gradually imbibe the popular and the current idea, which assumes that every time that we go to church, we will leave feeling on top of the world. And if we don't, then it's time to find a new church. Well, try telling Josiah that. Rather than looking for a new church, not that there was many for him to choose from, but rather than looking for a new church, and rather than telling Safan to turn to a different part of the Bible, a more encouraging part of the Bible, Josiah hears the words of the Lord. He confesses how far he and his fathers have fallen short, and he acknowledges that God's displeasure with them is perfectly justified. There are times when that is a right response to the Word of God. Thirdly, verses 22 to 28, a deliverance from the wrath of God. A deliverance from the wrath of God. Now, having been sent to inquire of the Lord in verse 21, Hilkiah and his colleagues went to Hilda, the prophetess who lived in Jerusalem, and here is what she said to them, verse 23. Tell the man who sent you to me, this is what the Lord says. I am going to bring disaster on this place and its people, all the curses written in the book that has been read in the presence of the king of Judah. Because they have forsaken me and burned incense to other gods and provoked me to anger by all that their hands have made, my anger will be poured out on this place and will not be quenched. However commendable Josiah's reforms may have been, it seems that they are not going to prevent Judah from experiencing divine judgment. Judah's sin is far too serious. Judah's sin is far too entrenched. Judah's sin is far too historical for the wrath of God to be averted at this late stage. But although Judah as a whole will not escape God's judgment, Josiah will. Did you hear what the prophet went on to say? Verse 27. Because your heart was responsive and you humbled yourself before God when he spoke against this place and this people, and because you humbled yourself before me and tore your robes and wept in my presence, I have heard you, declares the Lord. Now I will gather you to your fathers and you will be buried in peace. Your eyes will not see all the disaster that I'm going to bring on this place and on those who live here. Judah may not escape the horrific expression of God's wrath on a future day, but Josiah will. And he will do so because of his humble and his repentant response to the word of God. And did you know that everyone who responds to the word of God as Josiah did will likewise escape the wrath of God on a future day? What we must not forget when we read Old Testament history is that those occasions of divine judgment that occurred back then, such as the one on Judah and Jerusalem that the prophetess refers to in these verses, such occasions of divine judgment were foretaste or pointers pointing forward to the future and final day of judgment that will occur at the close of world history as we know it. Those expressions of God's wrath back then, they point forward to what the Apostle Paul describes in Romans chapter 2 as the day of God's wrath. And however horrific the downfall of Jerusalem would be, that future day of wrath, as described for us in our Bibles, that future day of wrath will be infinitely worse. And yet the good news tonight is that repentant sinners will be delivered from God's wrath on that future occasion. Writing to a group of people in the first century city of Thessalonica, Paul says this, 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 9. He says, they tell how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and the true God. That is repentance. And that is the repentance that we see in Josiah. And that is the repentance that still leads to deliverance from the wrath of God. But please note, it's not the repentance as such that turns aside God's wrath. No amount of repentance on our part, no amount of repentance on Josiah's part could ever achieve that. The only one who could turn aside God's righteous wrath from unrighteous people like you and me is Jesus. He is the wrath-quenching, propitiatory sacrifice whom God has provided for sinners like Josiah back then and for sinners like us today. Being sinless, being righteous, Jesus is the one who has endured God's wrath in the place of sinners, and in doing so turns aside God's wrath for all those who turn from their sin and trust in him. That is why Paul goes on to tell the Thessalonian Christians, they tell how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and the true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead. And then Paul says this, Jesus who rescues us from the coming wrath. Did you hear that? It's Jesus and Jesus only who can rescue us from coming wrath. And the great news tonight is that if you and I respond to the word of God in repentance and faith as Josiah did, then we too will know that deliverance from wrath that Jesus brings. Fourthly and finally, verses 29 to 33, and there we see a desire to obey the commands of God. A desire to obey the commands of God. Now, having been assured that he would escape the coming wrath that was coming upon Jerusalem and Judah, we might have expected Josiah to say something like, "Whew, that's a relief. I can now sit back and take things easy. I'm safe as far as divine judgment is concerned, and therefore I can do what I want, and I can live as I please from now on." That's what we might have expected him to say. But he doesn't. Instead, having received the great news from the prophetess, we read in verse 30 that having got all the people together, he read in their hearing all the words of the book of the covenant which had been found in the temple of the Lord. The king stood by his pillar and renewed the covenant in the presence of the Lord to follow the Lord and keep his commandments, regulations, and decrees with all his heart and all his soul and to obey the words of the covenant written in the book. And what he did himself, he got those he was responsible for to do as well. Verse 32, he made everyone in Jerusalem and Benjamin pledge themselves to it. Verse 33, he made all who were present in Israel serve the Lord their God. As long as he lived, they did not fail to follow the Lord, the God of their fathers. What a transformation. What a transformation Josiah's repentance and faith has brought about in his own life and in his society. His repentance and faith towards God has led to obedience. Obedience to God. Obedience to God's covenant and God's commandments. And many years later, and that is still how true repentance and faith manifests itself in the life of a Christian. That is why Paul can speak in 2 Corinthians 9 about the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ. As far as Jesus was concerned, our obedience to his commandments is the visible and tangible demonstration of our love for him. And that is why John can say in chapter 5 of his first letter, this is love for God. How would you finish that sentence? This is love for God. John says, to obey his commands. Please note, as I said this morning, it's not that our obedience merits God's love or God's salvation. We could never obey God enough for that to happen. Not even Josiah could do that. It is God who has first loved us, and he has done so unconditionally, and he has done so to the extent that he has sent his Son so that we might be rescued from future wrath. But having come to appreciate all that God in his love has done for us, we love him. And the way in which we express our love for him, the way we express our gratitude towards him, is, as we see in the case of Josiah, it's by seeking to obey all that he has said in his word. That is the desire, to obey the commands of God. Four things we see in the life and reign of King Josiah. Firstly, a concern for the worship of God. Secondly, a response to the word of God. Thirdly, a deliverance from the wrath of God. And fourthly, a desire to obey the commands of God. We're going to sing in closing. The hymn on the screen is a well-known hymn. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still and with all who will trust and obey. The chorus reads, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Standing to sing. Father, we thank you and praise you tonight that in spite of our waywardness, our sinfulness, in spite of our rebellion and our guilt, we thank you, our God, that you, in the fullness of time, sent one who could and would bear your wrath in our place. We thank you, our God, for our Lord Jesus Christ, for his willingness to take that judgment that we deserved upon himself. And we thank you and praise you, our God, that through repentance and faith in him, we thank you, our God, that we can have the assurance of being delivered from future wrath. Father, we do pray that those of us who have known that great blessing, that great salvation, Father, we do pray that you would help us, as Josiah has demonstrated. Help us, our God, to have that concern for the worship of God. And help us, our God, to have that concern to be obedient to him. Our God, we thank you for your word. We remember and look back at the great celebration, that great day when that book was found. And here we are, our God, with a completed Bible in our hands, our completed scriptures, the word of God in a language that we can read and understand. We do pray, our God, that you would help us to appreciate our privilege and to respond to your word as we should, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.